Stand and sing our flag.
Thank you.
So any children in fourth grade and below that would like to go will be dismissed to go out of the sanctuary doors to my right. We also, you may notice we don't have anyone passing offering plates this morning, but we do have offering plates available in the back of the sanctuary if you feel led to give anything at all. We also have a drop box on the office door. We have online giving through our website at FFBCJonesboro.com. If you are here for the very first time as a visitor, or if you've been here before but you've never filled out a visitor card, we'd love for you to fill one of those out. There should be one in front of the pew, in the pew in front of you, excuse me. Fill one of those out as much as you feel comfortable, and feel free to drop that in the offering plate on your way out this morning. And then I have a couple of announcements just for this week. In your bulletin this morning, there should have been a sheet with our nominating committee form. Now, if you are, oh, Miss Kimberly Pegg has graciously provided me with an example. It looks like this. Thank you. So this has a list of most of our ministries and ways to serve. And so if you're here and you are a member, you need to fill one of these out. Not if you feel like it, because you are a member here because God led you here, and you hopefully came and recognized, wow, this is a beautiful church and there are a lot of awesome things going on, and I want to be a part of what's going on here. But the only way that family fellowship operates is because our members faithfully serve in different capacities every week. And let me tell you, it is a disaster when those faithful members are out because they're sick or because they are on vacation. We notice their absence. And so we need all of our members, every one of you, if God has called you here, to find out where you are called to serve and where you can be faithful and to fill that out. And so we have a nominating committee who works very hard each year to work with you and work with the church to say, okay, what is needed? Where are spots that need to be filled? And where are you called and led? And so if you're here and you're a member, we want you to fill one of these sheets out about where you're interested in serving, whether that's on a committee to provide some leadership and guidance, or whether that's in a specific ministry serving, and maybe it's something that you don't have to do every week, but only as you're available, and that's okay. We will work with you. The nominating committee will work with you to figure out where you're available. And if you don't fill one out, you default go to changing diapers in the nursery. So I'm just telling you, you might be better throw them out. It's just easier that way. No, and that even that is a ministry that is needed. So if you're here and you are not a member, but you're interested in becoming a member in the next few weeks or even the next few months, go ahead and fill one of those out and maybe just mark that I'm not a member, but I'd like to become a member very soon, just so we can go ahead, the nominating committee can go ahead and start looking at, okay, how can they serve? And if you have any questions about that, if you need more information, come talk to me, talk to Brother Farrell, or if you're on the nominating committee real quick, can you raise your hand just so that people around you can see who you are? I know some of them aren't here this morning, so none of them are in here this morning. No one filled out that they wanted to be on the nominating committee last year, so no, I'm just teasing. I know that there are several members of the nominating committee, they just may not be in the sanctuary this morning. Hey, William's up in the balcony. William, you're going to get a lot of questions after service, but we don't care. No, I'm just teasing. But contact the office if you have questions as well. So with that being said, would you please pray for me, and we will continue to worship together. Our Heavenly Father, God, we are so blessed to have a church family. God, so filled with people who are willing to serve. God, that everyone who greets in the mornings, everyone who serves in a Sunday school class, in the nursery, in children's church, those who serve on our safety team each Sunday morning, Even the ones who make coffee, God, every one of them are doing it because you've called them to do it, and they want to glorify you with their lives. I pray, God, that you would give us all a heartfelt desire to serve you and serve your people and serve your church, and give us wisdom in how to do that well. I pray, God, as we continue to worship this morning, that we would lay our burdens aside, that our hearts and minds would be fixed on you. I pray, God, that our worship would be pleasing to you. We love you, God, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand and sing. You are God. This broken generation.
Bibles and turn to Jonah chapter 1. While you're turning there again, let me take just a moment to share my deepest appreciation to you, my church family, for your care and concern for my wife. You're providing for us through this difficult time, and most of all, your prayers. God is moved by prayer, and we need prayer. We'll tell you, she had her first round of chemo Friday. She had a good day Friday. She had a good day Saturday. Last night, things began to kind of wear on her quite a bit. And so pray for it, especially these next couple of days. Doctor says it'll be kind of tough for a couple of days, and then she'll get back on the uphill side of it. If you don't want to talk to her, that's fine. Okay. And I'm on up here too. The light is shining. But wherever I am, I'm here. So maybe we'll figure this out in just a moment. But anyway, pray for her as we go through these next several weeks that, yes, that God would heal.
Yes.
But that God would uphold, her attitude, her spirit, and that she would be at that place where she can say, no matter what, to God be
Amen.
The glory.
Amen.
Chris and I, so far in this journey, have constantly said, we gave our lives to the Lord in the good times. We continue to give our lives to the Lord in the difficult times. Now, the second thing I want to talk about, RJ has already mentioned. Can everybody hear me if I up the volume just a little bit?
We hear you.
Amen. Thank you, upstairs. You're good. I know it aggravates some people to no end to talk about salvation. And actually, I wish to God we didn't need them. I wish on Sunday morning you would run to the front and say, let me serve God in some capacity. You want something?
You need to change your batteries.
Steve loves batteries.
He's Radio Shack.
Oh.
What time was the announcement? It's at A7.
I'm almost afraid to open my mouth.
You guys say really?
No.
Okay.
We're moving into a new year. And I think I say this every year. We're one step closer to becoming the Lord Jesus. The church is more needed now than it's ever been.
Amen.
But for the church to be successful, it needs you. Not some of you, but all of you. God has gifted you. God has given you gifts, talents, and abilities. And He expects you to use them. I'm going to just meddle just a little bit this morning. It's time you quit hiding in the pew that you're sitting in. And say, God, you gave your life for me on Calvary. I'm ready to give my life for you on planet Earth. I believe with all of my heart, people will say, Lord, yes. We allow God to work not only in us, but through us. We can reach the community that God has planted us in. And that's our job. But it's going to take all hands on deck. I'm not being that pushy little preacher this morning. I really don't mean to be offensive. I just want to encourage you to be the best that you can be for the one who deserves the best that you can be.
Yes,
Jesus. Jonah chapter 1, we continue the series, Biblical Judgments. And I'm going to ask that you stand in honor of the reading of the Word of the Lord. A few verses to begin with this morning. Verse 1. Now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. Father, in Jesus' name, speak to our hearts through your words. May the Holy Spirit illuminate our minds. May he instruct our hearts as to the word and the will of God. God, I pray that already we have determined in our hearts that we're going to listen and we're going to trust and obey. That we have determined that we will leave here not as we arrived here, but different. For believers, crafted a little bit more in the image of the Lord Jesus. God, I pray that you would forgive me. I pray that you would cleanse me. I pray that you would empty me of self. And then fill me with your Spirit. Preach through me your word. That you may be glorified. That Jesus may be exalted. For it is in the name of Jesus that I pray. Man, let me see. My induction this morning. Did I keep you coming back?
Yes.
I'd like to say this has never happened to me before. I've got thumbs up. And what you don't know about me is I hate handheld mics with a passion. My introduction this morning will be the same as my completion. Short and sweet. Judgment is coming. Are you ready? Repent. Be saved. Repent and be set apart. Repent and serve the Savior. Again this morning, God's wrath, judgment announced. In verses 1 and 2, we begin with the word now. In the New Testament, and it came to pass, God's calendar. At this moment in time, God's appointment. And remember, brothers and sisters, God's time is not necessarily our time. Our time is not necessarily God's time. Now, the word of the Lord
A revelation from heaven. When God speaks, we need to listen. And sometimes I just think I need to say, guys, it's not what I say that matters. It is what thus saith the Lord.
Amen.
And I would challenge you this morning that you would listen well to the Word of God. I would challenge you this morning that you would tune out the noise of the world and listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit, because I promise you the Holy Spirit will speak today to you.
Yes.
Where the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai. When we were first introduced to Jonah back in 2 Kings chapter 14, verse 25, it said, "And the word of the Lord God of Israel, which he spake by the hand of his servant," doesn't sound like the Jonah that we know here, "the son of Amittai, the prophet, saying, Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city." Now, Nineveh was established by Nimrod. If that doesn't surprise you, it did me. The mighty hunter, Genesis chapter 10, making them the descendants of Ham, the son of Noah, now referred to as Gentile city because of the rejection of Jehovah, embracing false gods. It served as the capital of Syria for many years. Some of the great kings associated with Nineveh included Tiglath-Pileser III, Shalmaneser V, Sargon II, Ashurbanipal, and many others. And then it says, "And cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me." While God's knowledge is complete, he knew. Ours is not. What God knew, we don't necessarily know of that great city. But there are some things that history teaches us. In his commentary, Pharaoh wrote, "The Assyrian Empire was known for its cruelty. Judged from the vaulting inscriptions of her kings, no power more useless, more savage, more terrible ever cast its gigantic shadow on the page of human history as it passed on the way to ruin. The kings of Assyria tormented the miserable world. They extolled to record how space failed for corpses, how unsparing a destroyer is their goddess Ishtar, how they flung away the bodies of soldiers like so much clay, how they made pyramids of human heads, how they burned cities, how they filled populous lands with death and devastation, how they reddened broad deserts with carnage of warriors, how they scattered whole countries with the corpses of their defenders as with chaff, how they impaled heaps of men on stakes, and strewed the mountains and choked rivers with dead bones, how they cast off the heads of kings and nailed them on the walls and left their bodies to rot with bears and dogs on the entrance gates of the city, how they employed nations and captives in making brick and feathers, how they cut down warriors like weeds or smote them like wild beasts in the forest and covered pillars with the flayed skins of rival monarchs." God would have been just to have poured out his wrath without warning on this ungodly, ruthless, bloody nation. But that's not who God is. The judgment of God is often preceded by warning. And that's where Jonah comes in. God's warning, judgment, Jonah's assignment. There's three things here that I want you to consider with me this morning as we make our way through this great book. First, we see here the great commission of Jonah. "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness is come up before me." God's commission to Jonah was to leave where they weren't and go where they were. Not what we might expect from modern theology. You see, most Baptists would build a building, erect a sign, and place on the marquee, open for business. Y'all come, and then wait for the lost to arrive. You know, there's a reason the Great Commission says, go into all the world and make disciples. The reason? They will not come. Therefore, we must go. Like Jesus, who came to seek and to save, we must leave where they aren't. And they're not here, Brother Charles. And go where they are. They're in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. But then I would ask you to look at the great catastrophe of Jonah. But Jonah rose up to flee into Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa, he found a ship going to Tarshish. When but follows the command of the Lord, it is never good. Amen? God called, but Jonah disobeyed and ran from the Lord. The problem with his strategy? Every time you try to run from God, you know, you run into God. God knew where Jonah was going before Jonah reached his destination. I believe it was Charles Spurgeon who described God as heaven's bloodhound. You ready? He never loses the scent. So he paid the fare thereof and went down to it to go with them unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. I don't know what he paid for his ticket, but the expense was more than he expected. Charles Stanley often said, and I paraphrase, concerning the price of sin, it takes you further than you want to go, it costs you more than you want to pay, and keeps you longer than you want to stay. His passage secured, Jonah set sail for where God is not. But soon Jonah would come to understand that there is nowhere you can go where God is not. The psalmist wrote in Psalm 139, if I go to the mountaintop, God is there. If I go down into the valley, God is there. If I go to the depths of the sea, and Jonah was about to find out, God is there. If I go to the grave, God is there. There is nowhere where the omnipresent God is not. You see, you'd never play hide and seek with God. You know why? He cheats. He always knows where you're hiding before you hide. Now read with me this story. But the Lord sent out a great wind into the sea. And there was a mighty tempest in the sea, so that the ship was like to be broken. Then the mariners were afraid and cried every man unto his God. Now, can I stop for a moment? I appreciate these mariners, these sailors. They understood the suffering they were going through as a judgment from at least a God. My friends, we need to wake up and look around us and understand that many of the things that we're going through is because God, our God, has lifted his hand of grace. No, said. They cried every man to his God and cast forth the waves that were in the ship into the sea to lighten it of them. But Jonah was gone down into the sides of the ship, and he lay and was fast asleep. So the shipmaster came to him and said unto him, what meanest thou, O sleeper? Arise, call upon thy God, if so be that God will think upon us that we perish not. And they said everyone to his fellow, come, and let us cast lots, that we may know for whose cause this evil is upon us. So they cast lots, and the lot fell upon Jonah. Then said they unto him, tell us, we pray thee, for whose cause this evil has come upon us. What is thine occupation? And whence comest thou? What is thy country? And of what people art thou? And he said unto them, I am a Hebrew. the God of heaven, which hath made the sea and the dry land. And again, I will stop. Please understand what I'm about to say to you. The storm that they were going through was the result of a believer who was failing in his responsibility to God. The storms that they were suffering, the situation they were in, was not their problem. It was Jonah's problem. Guys, we are so fast to point our finger at the wickedness of the world. Their fault. Their fault. Their fault. And God says, no, not them. You. I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, which hath made the sea and the dry land. Then were the men exceedingly afraid and said to him, why hast thou done this? For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them. Then said they unto him, what shall we do unto thee, that the sea may be calm unto us? For the sea wrought and was tempestuous. And he said unto them, take me up, cast me forth into the sea, and so shall the sea be calm unto you. For I know that for my sake the great tempest has come upon you. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to bring it to the land, but they could not. For the sea wrought and was tempestuous against them. Wherefore they cried unto the Lord and said, we beseech thee, O Lord, we beseech thee. Let us not perish for this man's life. Lay not upon us as innocent blood, for thou, O Lord, hast done as it pleased thee. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. They say the prison on Alcatraz was inescapable. I don't know. What I do know is that you can't run far enough or fast enough to escape the reach of God. Just ask Jonah. I mean, think about it. Worse than any Motel 6, God made reservations for Jonah in the all-inclusive Mediterranean seaside resort. He had a single room all to himself. In keeping with the motif, his sheets were seaweed. He had unlimited access to the natural springs of the fish's hot gastric juices. And unlike Motel 6, the lights were never on. And different from Jaws, I got to watch that yesterday, so it's fresh in my mind. This is Shark Week. Different from Jaws, the bite of the great fish was not lethal. Swallowed alive, Jonah contemplated his situation. Which brings us to the great confession of Jonah. And Jonah prayed unto the Lord his God out of the fish's belly and said, I cried by reason of my affliction to the Lord, and he heard me. Amen. Out of the belly of hell cried I, and thou heardest my voice. For thou hast cast me to the deep in the midst of the seas, and the floods compassed me about. All thy billows and all thy waves passed over me. And I said, I am cast out of thy sight. Yet I will look again toward the holy temple. The waters compassed me about, even to the soul. The depth closed me round about. The weeds were wrapped about my head. I went down into the bottom of the mountains. The earth with her bars were about me forever. Yet hast thou brought up my life in corruption, O Lord my God. When my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came in unto thee into thine holy temple. They that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercy, but I will sacrifice unto thee with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay that I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. And the Lord spake unto the fish, and it vomited out Jonah upon the dry land. Here again is a word of exhortation. You can either allow your situation to drive you from God or drive you to God. Jonah could have been bitter and blamed God, but he recognized he was the source of the problem. He was thankful God's mercy extended even into the fish's belly. And he spoke and evoked the promise of Hebrews 4:16. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. While he did not know the verse, it would be appropriate to him if we confess our sin, and Jonah did. God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, cleanse us of all unrighteousness. And that was Jonah's God. Jonah repented of his rebellion. God restored him. And in that moment, God caused the fish to reject him onto the seashore where he would begin again the ministry to which God had called. Which brings me to an interesting part of this story. Something we don't often see. God's wrath, judgment averted. And the word of the Lord came unto Jonah the second time. You didn't listen the first time, Jonah. Here we go. Arise, go into Nineveh, that great city, and preach unto it the preaching that I bid thee. So Jonah arose and went into Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceeding great city of 3 days' journey. And Jonah began to enter into the city a day's journey, and then he cried and said, yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. So the people of Nineveh believed God and proclaimed a fast and put on sackcloth from the greatest of them even to the least of them. For word came unto the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, and he laid his robe from him and covered him with sackcloth and sat in ashes. And he caused it to be proclaimed and published through Nineveh by the decree of the king and his nobles, saying, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything, let them not feed nor drink water. But let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily unto God. Yea, let them turn every one of them from his evil way and from the violence that is in their hands. Who can tell if God will turn unto men and turn away from his fierce anger that we perish not? And God saw their works, and they turned from their evil way. And God repented of the evil that he had said that he would do unto them, and he did it not. I think Jonah's message, Brother Randy, was simple. Repent. First point. Repent. Second point. Repent. Third point and a point. Repent. Invitation. Repent. Reject the warning and perish. Reject the warning and experience God's, or receive the warning and receive God's mercy and grace. Today that message hasn't changed. Repent or perish. Anytime the gospel is preached, repent or perish. It's kind of like we find in the Old Testament, choose ye this day. See, I set before your life and death. You make the decision. Repent or perish. Receive Jesus. Repent of your sins and escape the wrath of God. And I trust you have or will do that. Reject Jesus Christ as Savior and experience the wrath of God. Your choice. Sitting right where you are, in your own heart, don't say it out loud, you say, my choice. It's not my choice for you. It's not your choice for me. My choice. What will you do? Well, praise God. Nineveh repented, and God halted destruction. Not exactly what Jonah wanted, but it was what he expected. Jonah chapter 4. And by the way, when I finish reading this fourth chapter, you will have read the entire book of Jonah. So that's not what we pay you for, preacher. You're supposed to develop pretty little sermons out of those passages of Scripture. Dr. Robert Smith preach, maybe you may have heard this. I heard him preach one time on the book of Jonah. And that's the way he introduced the sermon. He said, I'm going to preach you on the book of Jonah. And I thought, wow, the book of Jonah? By the time he finished 1:1 through chapter 4, verse 11, he had read every verse of the passage. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly. And that's kind of like me getting upset if somebody walked down the aisle and getting saved. And he was very angry, and he prayed unto the Lord and said, I pray thee, O Lord, was not this my saying when I was yet in my country? Therefore I fled before unto Tarshish. For I knew that thou art a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger, and a great kindness, and repented thee of the evil. Therefore now, O Lord, take, I beseech thee, my life from me, for it is bitter for me to die, or better for me to die than to live. Then said the Lord, dost thou well to be angry? So Jonah went out of the city and sat on the east side of the city, and there made him a booth and sat under it in the shadow till he might see what would become of the city. And the Lord God prepared a gourd and made it to come up over Jonah, that it might be a shadow over his head to deliver him from his grief. So Jonah was exceeding glad of the gourd. But God prepared a worm. When the morning rose the next day, it smote the gourd that it withered. And it came to pass, when the sun did arise, that God prepared a vehement east wind, and the sun began to beat upon the head of Jonah, that he fainted and wished himself to die, and said, it is better for me to die than to live. And God said to Jonah, dost thou well be angry for the gourd? And he said, I do well to be angry, even unto death. Then said the Lord, thou hast had pity on the gourd, for the which thou had not labored, neither madest it grow, which came up in the night and perished in the night. And should not I spare Nineveh, that great city, wherein are more than 60,000 persons, we believe this to mean children, that cannot discern between their right hand and their left hand, and also much cattle. Jonah's prejudice would have allowed thousands to perish. He let his hatred overshadow the heart of God. And the heart of God is this. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Red and yellow, black and white. God is not willing that any should perish. Asian, Indian, European, African, Hispanic. God is not willing that any should perish. Islam, Buddhism, Hinduism, God is not willing that any should perish. Agnostic or atheist, God is not willing that any should perish. Good or bad, bond or free, God is not willing that any should perish. Upper class, middle class, lower class, or no class, God is not willing that any should perish. The scripture says God demonstrated his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. See, God's vision is very narrow when it comes to us. You are either saved or you're lost. And that's it. He doesn't see the skin color. He doesn't see, were you raped in society? He doesn't see from whence you came. It doesn't bother him, the religion. God just sees you as lost or found. A sinner or a saint. And that's the way we need to view the world around us. Everyone you meet Don't worry about their, where they park here in the middle or on the side. Don't worry about what they're wearing. Don't worry about what the tattoos say or don't say on their bodies. All you need to worry about is what God is worried about. There's your soul belong to Him. We've reached the final chapter of the book of Jonah, but not the end of the story. God's wrath, judgment accomplished. Around 612 BC, Nineveh was destroyed by Babylon. Under the leadership of Nabopolassar, the father of Nebuchadnezzar. The same nation God used or God raised up to defeat Judah, God would use to finalize the prophetic warning spoken by Jonah more than 100 years earlier. While Nineveh repented of the preaching of Jonah and was temporarily spared, soon after they returned to their idolatry, immorality, and brutality, God brought judgment. The prophetic destruction of Nineveh, by the way, is recorded in the book of Nahum, chapter 3. What would happen to Nineveh reminds us God is not mocked. Whatsoever man sows, that shall he also reap. And it stands as a warning to our own nation. What we were, one nation under God, does not exempt us from what we have become. This once blessed of the Lord nation may soon know what it is to experience the wrath of Almighty God, the Holy, Holy, Holy One of Israel, if we do not return unto the Lord. So I leave with you the warning or the encouragement of 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people who call on my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. Conclusion? Same as the introduction. Judgment is coming. You know that? Judgment is coming. Are you ready? This is a dramatic pause. Are you ready? Repent and be saved. Repent of your sin. Repent and be separate, saith the Lord. Repent and serve the Savior. While there is yet time. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray, Lord, this morning that you would use the story of Jonah to remind us that judgment is an inescapable reality of who you are. And one day we will stand in judgment before you. Now I am so thankful, Father, that Jesus Christ stood in our place. That he became sin for us and we were sin. Your judgment was upon him. And so, Lord, that's why we can gospel of Jesus Christ, when we refuse the blood of the Lamb, that one day we will stand before you and have you say to us, "Depart from me, ye that work iniquity, into the place prepared for the devil and his demons, the place of suffering, forever separated from me." Lord, even as believers, judgment still lives. You spoke with the Apostle Paul, and every one of us shall give an account of ourselves.
As you finish your training, please turn it in, and the nominating committee will begin working on those. Today, right after worship service, youth and youth families, we are going to Debbie and Jerry Jocelyn's house. They have all opened up their homes for us to have lunch, and so we're grilling out and enjoying the nice soggy weather. Now we're going to have a really, really good time and have a lot of fun fellowship planned. And then next Saturday is one of the favorite youth events of the year. It is our youth lake trip. And so teenagers and families, you're invited to come with us next Saturday. The bus will be leaving Saturday morning at 7 a.m. and going to Greer's Ferry Lake. And you're going to be spending the day tubing, wakeboarding, cliff jumping, swimming, whatever else we want to be doing. Yeah, I can say cliff jumping. We do that. It's fun. No one's died. They've been injured. They've not died. No. We do have a great time, though. Senior adults, your potluck is this coming. Next Tuesday is your potluck. We will have Bible study this Tuesday at 9:30. Some of you guys who are in our family introductions class have been asking me about that, so please come check that out. Talk to Brother Charles if you have questions. And then take a look at our prayer list. It's been updated. There's some of our church members that are hurting and dealing with different situations, and so pray for them. And as you see these church members and their family members, please talk to them and encourage them and see what they need. Are there any other announcements or things that I've missed? Yes, Stephanie? Okay, movie night Tuesday night. Children, youth are welcome. What time do we need to be here? 6 to 8. Chris Wheeler's getting pretty good with that popcorn machine, so make sure y'all show up. And we're going to have a great time. The first night was a disaster, but we got better. So any other announcements, anything else that I've missed? All right. God bless you. You are dismissed.
You run down. You run down.